Good evening, all. September 14, 2021, 7 o'clock p.m. This is a meeting of the Southfield Board of Education in public for the purpose of conducting the school district's business. It is not to be considered as a community meeting. There is one opportunity for public participation during the meeting, and comments are limited to 3 minutes per individual. The board will listen to comments, but may not respond during the meeting. If you are physically present and wish to address the board, please submit a comment card immediately. If you are participating virtually and wish to address the board, please raise your hand when public participation arises on the agenda. Roll call. Charles Hicks, Board President.
Gerald B. Joyce, Vice President.
Ashanti Nguyen, Treasurer.
Trustees, dialed in remotely, please announce. Trustee Smith Thomas, are you unmuted? I see you talking.
I just unmuted her.
Is Trustee Rice on? So I'm going to announce on behalf of Trustee Smith Thomas, Board Secretary. Dr. Green?
Did you want to announce Trustee Rice?
Is she on?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. And also online is Trustee Rice. Dr. Green.
Thank you, Board President. Dr. Jennifer Green, Superintendent, and taking notes today is that of Ms. Laura Norris. Also, we have online several members of our executive cabinet, as well as several of our principals. Tonight, Ms. Sonia Jackson will be presenting to our trustees in our community.
Pledge of Allegiance. So if we all can do that together, please.
Board President.
Ma'am.
Our student board reps are online as well.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So I want to make sure we acknowledge our students.
I'm sorry. We want, with the student board reps, if you can unmute, please introduce yourself. Well, in the interim, I just wanted to announce that Divinity Davis, who represents Southfield High School for the Arts and Technology, and Demonay Payne, who represents University High School Academy. You'll be hearing from these young ladies shortly.
Okay.
Now for the Pledge of Allegiance. Now, if you want to do this, we can do it sitting. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Board matters. First of all, I'd like to say welcome back to the 2021-2022 school year. We want to thank all the students who are our customer as well as our product that we produce. We want to thank all the administrators, support staff, teachers, all those who support educating our future. And last but not least, we thank the parents and the community for all the support that you give in helping us move our children to the next level. I want to take a moment of silence because over the course of the pandemic, we've lost a lot of people from the district for various reasons. And we just want to take a moment of silence to remember their contributions that they made on behalf of Southfield Public Schools. So if we could just take a moment of silence, please. Thank you. Trustees, are there any board matters at this time?
Board President.
I do, Board.
Okay. I think I heard Trustee Rice as well as Trustee Smith Thomas. Trustee Rice.
Thank you. I'd like to take this time to thank everyone for their kindness, their support, and comforting words. I greatly appreciate all of the cards, flowers, and sentiments of sympathy during my time of bereavement. I just really want to thank everyone.
Thank you, Trustee Rice. Trustee Smith-Thomas.
Yes, thank you, Board President. Board President, is there another way I can participate in tonight's meeting? I am having a really hard time hearing, and I'm afraid when it's time to take votes, that may be a challenge. That's not my board matters, but I just realized as I didn't hear the meeting call to order that I'm having some audio.
I'm sorry.
I too, Board President, did hear the meeting call to order.
Okay.
It kind of cut in the middle.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Is that better? Trustee Smith-Thomas or Rice?
Can you hear Trustee Smith-Thomas?
I can hear a little bit better.
Okay. One moment.
Is this better?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes, that's much better. So for my board matters, I do want to express the same sentiments of welcome back, everyone. And I also want to share with our community, our stakeholders, especially our educators, that I am 100% in favor of meeting in person. I do have a medical matter happening in my home at this time. It happened, came up just yesterday, which is why I am calling in and participating virtually. Otherwise, I will be there in person with you all.
Understood. And thank you for sharing. At this point,
Board President, if I may.
Yes, ma'am.
One thing I wanted to lift to our parents and teachers. First of all, thanks for all of your patience as we're getting back into the swing of school. The second thing I wanted to add is it is important that we keep in mind that one of our goals is to make sure that our children are safe. So I am going to lift into the conversation and to administration.
Just for a moment. Are you on the headset? Turn your microphone off for a second. No, your physical microphone. Did you turn this one off? This one here?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks. And keep your headset on.
Is that better? Okay. It's important that we work to make sure that we keep our children safe. I'm going to ask if there's a way that our administration can put into place a policy for K through 5 to remain on the premises during pickup for the safety of our children. And if parents are requesting that their children be picked up elsewhere from 6 through 8, that they write a letter. I just want to make sure that everyone, as far as school policy and administrators and teachers and parents and students are all on the same page when it comes to safety. And I think this would be one way to make sure that we are all held accountable to the safety of our children. That's all that I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Word of all. Any other board matters?
Yes, ma'am.
My only board matter would be to remind all parents that when you get on our campuses, please wear a mask. It's just for the safety of our students, our families, and our faculty. And thank you so much for bringing your kids back and trusting us with their safety during the school day.
So, community, just want to ask that you bear with us. We're working out some of the kinks of trying to marry virtual world with meeting in public. So as we continually get better, we ask you to stay patient with us. We'll get this thing going smoothly. Report of the student board representatives. Ms. Divinity Davis, Southfield High School for the Arts and Technology.
Divinity, can you hear us? I just unmuted you again. Try speaking now.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah. He's frozen. Try now if you can, Divinity.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I actually did not hear anything. My Wi-Fi was reconnecting.
Your board report is up if you're ready to share, please.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
You want me to share to the screen or just read it?
You can just read it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Give me 1 second. Okay. Hi, my name is Divinity Davis. I'm the student board representative for Southfield A&T. So on August 28th, the Southfield A&T Warriors football team had their season opener at Wayne State against Cass Technical High School. At the game, the cheerleaders and the marching band performed at halftime. Unfortunately, we did not win the game with a score of 49-22, but one of our athletes, Alik McCain, won the award titled Ironman. And then on Friday, September 3rd, the football team played against Birmingham Groves, where we did win the game with a final score of 33-7. There was a home game on September 10th, where we won the game. The score, I don't remember the score, but I do know that we won. And the marching band performed at this game as well. The other fall sports that we have going on right now are cheer, marching band, boys tennis, girls golf, and volleyball. With this being our second, well, after we just completed our second week of the school year, we are still adjusting to the new policy, but we just started doing our grade level meetings. Where at these meetings, we just, the administrators share like upcoming events, new rules, policies, and our principal, Mrs. Hall, said that our mask mandate is going very well. We also have a club called Link Crew, where seniors help like show the freshmen around and help them get adjusted to the school. And they just had a game night on Thursday, September 9th, last Thursday. The upcoming events that we have, the SAC Marching Band has a tagging event this Friday where we just raise money for like upcoming events. And the football team is playing an away game at Clarkston on Friday. And that is all I have.
Thank you.
So all Ms. Payne was not be joining us at this time, but I want you all to know a little bit about Ms. Davis and Ms. Payne. Several of our trustees went through an interview process of a variety of students. And it was really challenging because the bar is really set high with the amount of students that they interviewed and how well they did. But we definitely have some, all-star students with Ms. Davis and Ms. Payne who truly represent Southfield Public Schools. And as our product, as well as our customer, we are thankful for their support in working with us and representing their respective high schools. So we look more to hear more from them as we go on each month. And thank you for your support and working with us in your respective roles. Report of the superintendent, Dr. Green.
Thank you, Board President. I think they can hear me. Are you able to hear me, Trustee Smith-Thomas? Okay, great. Good afternoon, everyone. Ms. Norris, if you could please share the PowerPoint presentation. Board President, would you like to dismiss Divinity so that she could study this evening?
So, Ms. Davis?
Ms. Davis, we thank you for your time, but it's time for you to finish your homework if you hadn't done so already. Talk to you soon.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Okay. Thank you. This evening, I tried to place everything in a PowerPoint to capture the opening of schools and then to address some of the school and community concerns that we have heard since the beginning of school. And now we are into our third week. As always, Ms. Norris is pulling that up on the screen. As always, I'd like to remind us and keep us centered on our vision that we will develop socially responsible and culturally sensitive citizens empowered to meet the challenges of a rapidly changing global and technologically advanced society. Next slide, please. You can go into. And with that, we have the mission of educating all students in a collaborative, safe, supportive, and high quality, student-centered environment that prepares dynamic, innovative learners to compete within the global society. Next slide. Okay, very good. And for those of you that forgot the pandemic, let me take you back to March of 2020. I think that we are all very well versed in all the changes and twists that we experienced. We started in March 2020 with distance learning, came back in June of 2020 with virtual and independent learning. In August of 2020, went to remote learning. February 2021, hybrid learning. June 2021, virtual and independent learning. First of which we had in-person students summer camps. And then August 2021, now we are full in-person instruction 5 days per week. This is the slide I really wanted to put some attention to this evening. We have heard this community, we have heard the schools relative to the concerns. We want you to know that everything that has been lifted to our attention, we are addressing. That being staffing, I know that people think the staff shortages are only applicable to Southfield Public Schools. However, they are applicable to all school districts, not only in the state of Michigan, the Midwest area, as well as on a national level. I polled my colleagues from Oakland County just yesterday, and one neighboring district that a lot of people reference in comparison to Southfield stated that they have 7 open positions. And for those are certified staff members. For non-certified staff, they said they have a significant deficit in those areas. Another district that is to our west stated that special education personnel remain their greatest priority, and they too are having challenges with non-certified staff. So I wanted to lift that to let everyone know that it is not exclusive to Southfield Public Schools. There is a bidding war for talent right now relative to educators, because for far too long, people were not going into the field of education, and we've had a mass exodus as a direct result of the pandemic. We are diligently seeking bus drivers, custodial, noon hour aides, food service, as well as instructional and non-instructional staff for the district. No, go back. We'll be on the slide for a moment. Our COVID dashboard is on our district homepage. There have been numerous changes to the procedures in regard to what the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services issued, in regard to what the Oakland County Health Department issues. I want to be clear that when it comes to policy or procedures, the state level generally trumps the county level in terms of procedures, unless the county is more restrictive. They cannot be less restrictive, but they can be more restrictive. On September 8th, the state put out new guidance. They revised that guidance on September 10th. And as of this afternoon, the county will have a new document tomorrow that is more restrictive than that of the state. That said, I ask for everyone's patience as we continue to evolve throughout this pandemic and this return back to in-person instruction. It continuously changes, sometimes on a daily basis. In regard to notifications, Southfield Public Schools notifies every impacted individual impacted, meaning if your child is positive and or a close contact. We do not notify contacts of close contacts or the general public. We notify the general public by way of our COVID dashboard, which is on the district's webpage. And we do that within 24 hours of having been notified. Our traffic patterns, we recognize that we have more cars on the road, particularly at our elementary schools, as we've offered an incentive for elementary parents to help with social distancing on the buses. That said, we are working with the Southfield Police Department as well as the Oakland County Road Commission to address the traffic patterns at McIntyre, MacArthur, University Middle and High School, Stevenson, and Southfield High School for the Arts and Technology. As one trustee lifted, please be patient when you are on our campuses because our babies, even our high school babies, are darting out in front of cars and their safety is of the utmost importance to us. Board President, I saw you pick up your headphones. I didn't know if you had a comment. Okay. Transportation, Board Policy 8600. That references our walk zone versus that of our busing. Our current policy states that if you live within a mile of the school, you are in the walk zone. I do understand, based on some phone calls I received, that some individuals have been afforded transportation, although they were not entitled to transportation. And with this year being our full return and our attempt to social distance on the buses, we are adhering to the board policy. Therefore, there are some individuals that were afforded opportunities that are no longer afforded those opportunities because they were not within the boundaries specified by the board policy. We are also affording some of our elementary families gas cards on a monthly basis to drive their children to and from school to, again, create additional social distancing on our buses. Next, the topic of athletics and spectators. We are not allowing any guests into our buildings. Therefore, we are not allowing any spectators into our buildings to date. However, as situations improve, as the conditions improve, we have discussed increasing and or allowing some spectators at the indoor volleyball games. We have not officially made that announcement or that recommendation because we are working through some of the logistical pieces to ensure that we keep our student athletes and our families safe. We have recently increased the number of spectators, afforded an opportunity to go to the outdoor athletic events to ensure that their families have an opportunity to see them, particularly those that are seniors. And we also stream those games live so that their families can see it in real time, which also affords them an opportunity to share their experience with their family members that live out of state. Extracurricular activities, we are deciding those on a case-by-case basis. Most recently, in speaking with the high school administration, we are going to have a homecoming. However, that date may be pushed off to ensure that we are able to have all of the proper protocols in place to ensure that our children are safe in doing that. Our clubs are operational if it is sponsored by a Southfield Public Schools employee. If it is an outside club, it is not operational within our buildings. That is not to say that they are not meeting off campus. They are just not meeting inside of the school. In terms of enrollment, I am pleased to share that Middle Cities projected us to have 4,500 students this year based on everything that has happened. And as of today's count, we are almost at 4,900 students. 4,900 is still slightly less than what we're accustomed to. We're accustomed to being over 5,000. However, I did want to lift that the families that selected virtual have been removed from that number, which is why we're at the 4,900. Once we finish this year and families return to in-person, pending the health conditions improve, our numbers will once again increase. However, it's important to note that even with that virtual attendance, we are 300 to 400 above the Middle City's projection. Last but definitely not least, I believe Mr. Rodell is on the line because he is going to speak to you trustees as well as our community regarding the food service. Mr. Rodell, you are a panelist, if you would unmute.
I'm here. First and foremost, good evening, everybody. congratulations to all the other educators and everyone that's here. Welcome back to school. This year had been close to 20 years I've been in food service, had been the most challenging of any year. Just because we are going through a very, very severe staff shortage. And on top of that, we have a second caveat and variable that we are dealing with, and that is there's product shortages going on as well, not just exclusive to our area, but across the whole entire country. Just as an example, to a district that is near us, I heard about this the other day. They ordered, I think, about 5,000 hamburger buns for the week to be used. They get a once a week delivery, and 150 showed up. And the bread vendor said that they did not have any bakers to bake bread, so they were scrambling to be able to get buns. The good thing about it is that even though we are going through what we're going through, we have been very, very diligent and judicious to making sure we stay in compliant, making sure that we're doing everything that we can. I myself was on a truck today because I had a driver that was not in. All of me, myself, my whole entire staff have been out there working daily, but I am believing that things are going to get better over the next 30 to 60 days. So I'm hoping that I will be in a much better position after that. And I'm here if you guys have any questions. Don't mind answering.
Thank you, Mr. Rodell. Not hearing any at this time.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think Trustee Smith-Thomas may have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Not a question. Good evening, Mr. Rodell. Really more of a compliment. I was not expecting to hear that, especially after the message went out that all families, all students, I would say, are eating for free this year.
Yes.
And that is commendable considering the circumstances that you're working under. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I just want to say thank you publicly to Dr. Green. Dr. Green called me today. I'm in the truck, and I said I was literally almost in tears when she called, because I thought that she was gonna tell me about something, and she just told me, she goes, "Perk up, you know, I need you to do this." And I was like, you don't know how much that meant to me, Dr. Green, and, you know, such a tough day today, but I appreciate it. Thank you so much for a great partnership.
Thank you, Rodell. It's an important partnership. Ms. Norris, you may need to mute. I also want to lift that Rodell and I met this past week to discuss the salad bars. And while we want our children to have salad and nutritional items, we recognize that open and exposed things may not be the best for the duration of this pandemic. That said, we are going to have packaged fresh fruit and salad items so that our children will still have the opportunity to indulge in those healthy items. However, the transition from where we were to where we are headed would take approximately 1 to 2 weeks per Mr. Rodell. So I just wanted to lift that for the families that think that the salad is gone forever. It's not. It will be back as soon as possible. Next slide, Ms. Norris.
I think there's a question from Trustee Jones.
I'm sorry.
Oh, yes, no problem. If while we have Mr. Rodell, if he could speak to the importance of families completing the form, the income verification form. I'm probably not stating that correctly.
The household survey.
Yes.
Well, we actually have two. So Southfield is blessed to have had several of our schools community eligible CEP. So those schools such as Adler, Thompson, Levy, Stevenson, Southfield Regional, all fill out what they call a household survey. And that survey has the very same effect of a free and reduced application form, which is also available for the rest of the schools. Both forms are in the Southfield website, and they're both updated. You can fill one out virtually, and it will be submitted, evaluated, approved. And whether you're approved or not approved, because of the current waiver that we are in, the whole entire district will be continue to receive free breakfast, lunch, and supper. I shouldn't say supper, it's supper for Southfield High School. But the importance of this is vital because a lot of our funding is tied in to processed applications. So it's vital for every particular student and parent that whether you are, you know, you're going to get approved or whether you think you're not going to get approved, you know, there's a lot of title funding connected to our free and reduced applications as well as our surveys. I think, Dr. Green, if you don't mind kind of expounding more on what grants and what funding is associated with those, if that's a question.
Thank you, Rodell. Actually, all funding stemming from the federal government is tied to that percentage. That's the Title I formula allocation, and the COVID grants that we've received, the ESSER grants that we've received, all of those things are tied back to the percentage of those applications having been processed, regardless as to whether or not they were approved for the free or reduced lunch. It also impacts some of our partnership grants, such as United Way, not the private philanthropic, but anything that may be tied to federal funding. Very important. Ms. Harvey did send that information out via email. I will ask that it is included in our next update, our next parent newsletter, in the event that someone is unable to locate it on our website. One of the big questions that we are often asked is how is Southfield Public Schools spending their money, particularly that of the COVID funding and the ESSER dollars? We often hear, based on the media, that we are receiving a large number, a significant number of dollars from the federal government. The truth is, while we have been promised those dollars, we have not received all of those dollars, yet we have utilized the dollars we were entitled to benefit our students. Ms. Norris, if you could advance the screen so that we can go into further explanation. Allocations and projected expenditures beginning with the fiscal year 2020 through today. In the second category, you will see that the ESSER II funds were just released late August 2021. Our children were walking back in the door in August of 2021. So all of the purchases that we made, all of the upgrades, all of the modifications, those things were purchased separate and apart from the ESSER II. That came from ESSER I, it came from the CARES grant and the Educational Equity Grant and the Oakland County CARES grants. We have been diligent in seeking partnerships to ensure that our children have what they need. The third large bullet is ESSER III. That is our largest pot of money having been promised from the federal government. To date, we have not received it, nor have we received a date when it will be released. That is the $14 million that everyone wants to know what Southfield Public Schools is doing with it. We don't have it, so we're not doing anything with it at this time. Ms. Norris, if you would advance the screen, we have a visual for our community to see. This is a representation of all of the grant dollars having been received or promised throughout this pandemic. And you will see that of all of the dollars having been promised to us, the ESSER III, which we've yet to receive, is the largest pot of money. So while the other dollars are significant, they total approximately $11 million, and we don't take that for granted, we still have a lot of work that needs to be done, and we need the funding in order to make it happen. Next slide. How is that broken down? You will see that we have some of it going to salaries and benefits, and people automatically think, oh, those are your current employees. Those may be some current employees in terms of additional academic supports. None of that blue represents administrative costs. I want to be clear with that. It's either academic support or social emotional support. That represents the district nurses that we plan to hire. That represents the social emotional supports that will be placed at the elementary schools and any other staff that would be hired to provide direct services to our students. Supplies, anything from classroom supplies, COVID supplies, or any other materials, purchase services could be that of, again, supports from an outside agency coming to work with our students. It could be professional development for our teaching staff and or professional development for our families. And then there is that small orange sliver, which is $231,000. That is indirect costs. Our staff is now tasked with not only monitoring the fiscal end of Southfield Public Schools, but we have to monitor the fiscal responsibility of every private school within a 25-mile range that receives money by way of Southfield Public Schools. We are the fiduciary. So that $231,000 is an offset to the district to cover the duties and responsibilities that have been placed upon us throughout this pandemic. Be mindful that we had a two-person grant team prior to the pandemic. Now they have 10 times the amount of work placed on their hands to ensure that we are remaining fiscally responsible. And to date, we have indeed. Next slide, Ms. Norris. Just to show you some of the things we've done with the grant dollars in real time, how does it impact us? For our class of 2021, we offset their graduation. The students did not have to pay senior dues. We provided them not only with the first in-person graduation since 2019, but we also provided them with lawn signs and other tokens to remember their high school career. Next slide. We had a fully funded summer program. Our camps, our credit recovery programs, everything that we did on the campus of Southfield Public Schools this summer was fully funded at no cost to our families. Next slide. We had several communication initiatives. From day one of my arrival, I heard from our families that communication was an issue. So we wanted to put additional attention on our communications. We had digital billboards, radio ads, print ads, direct mailers, Michigan Chronicle, digital ads, Facebook posts, and fence banners. Next slide. We hosted a back to school fair where every school received their own custom tent. In addition to the custom tents, we purchased a large number of tents for every school to afford our teachers an opportunity to go into the courtyards and or teach outside when the weather is conducive. Nothing like today, it was too dangerous. But on any other day, we encourage our staff to go outside with the students for lessons because they have a better airflow and air quality when they're outdoors. And it also affords them an opportunity to take a rest from wearing the mask. Next slide. We also made a sizable investment in technology. We replaced approximately 5,500 Chromebooks, 575 new laptops for our staff with cases, monitors, wireless mouse, docking stations, and cameras. We purchased hotspots. Not only did we purchase the hotspots, we paid the bills for the hotspots for those families in need for the entire duration of the pandemic. We had network upgrades, including but not limited to the installation of fiber cable to the Warrior Field to ensure that our families can stream live. We invested in software, particularly that of the frontline daily health screener, of which I'd like to remind families that it's important, extremely important, that they fill out that daily health screener every day. We also invested in the COVID kiosk that you see at the front of every building. We wish to make a future investment in interactive boards for the classrooms. However, we could not cover those out of the current grant dollars. Therefore, we seek additional grant dollars, which reiterates the importance of completing those household survey forms. We also made a sizable investment in curriculum and assessment tools. Schoology Seesaw Everyday Math. I won't read the list to you. You see the list in front of you. All of our adoptions have online components. Therefore, our families have access to all materials, both on and off the campus. Next slide. We had capital improvements relative to temperature controls at Adler, Kennedy, Southfield High School for the Arts and Technology, and Stevenson Elementary. We had the transportation access road and fuel tank where we removed a 10,000 gallon underground storage tank and replaced it with a new above ground storage tank. That is for our buses and for our backup generators when the power goes out. There to the left, you'll see what was removed from the ground and the significant hole remaining. And then to the right, at the lower right screen, you see the new tank. Our emergency operations plan was updated, whereby all doors throughout our entire district are now marked with numbers to ensure that in the event of an emergency, our first responders know exactly what door to respond and can get there in a relatively short amount of time. Next slide. This is bid package 7. Bernie K-8 received all new mechanical updates. They have all new heating and cooling throughout the entire building. Our ultimate goal will be to have that throughout the entire district. However, that project alone costs approximately $5 million, just to put things in perspective regarding the funding we've received to date. We also have new parking lots at Adler, McIntyre, Stevenson, and Vandenberg. And you see there that investment was a little over $2 million. Next slide. Couple photos. We have some capital improvement work happening in the wellness rooms, particularly that of Adler, Kennedy, McIntyre, and Stevenson, to the tune of $302,000. The culinary kitchen code compliance, that is an item on tonight's agenda. However, the board was gracious enough to verbally give us the approval to move forward with that over the summer, given that our kitchen was not ADA compliant and we want to afford all of our students an opportunity to engage in all of our programs. So that is what this bid package references. The University High School chiller replacement. We know that the first couple of days of school were significantly warm, not only in the buildings, but outside of the buildings as well. We do have a plan in place to replace the chiller at the University High School. That costs approximately $200,000. Other capital improvements, we did have to replace the chiller at the ITC, which is our Instructional Technology Center. Had we not replaced that chiller and it became overheated, we would subject all of our district technology to a complete shutdown. Mitigation measures, we also made significant investment in mitigation measures. Next slide. Student and staff desk shields, and I want to stop there for a moment because I understand that some parents have reached out relative to the student desk shields. We purchased enough desk shields in the spring for every student in our district plus some. Between us dismissing school in June and our return, many of the shields went missing. Now, it could be due to the construction that occurred throughout our district and some of the cleanup that occurred. Perhaps they disposed of some of them. We don't know. However, what we do know is we are committed to providing those. Therefore, we have placed a rush order to get additional shields in our district for every student to have one. We also have a sizable amount of masks available for any student that may arrive without one. I spoke with some of the trustees earlier and they shared that there are some students coming every day requesting a mask. We have cloth masks that can be washed or laundered. If the family is unable to do so, we will make provisions to launder those masks. We are not in position to continuously provide disposable masks on a daily or hourly basis. However, we do have in our current supply at least, I think, 4 masks for every student throughout the school year. So we do have them on reserve, but we do not want to utilize all of them in the first month of school. So we ask everyone to be mindful of that. Again, we are providing the transportation opt-out incentive for the elementary families. That's $25 gift card per month, specifically that of a gas gift card to transport their student. We've upgraded our disinfectant to that of hospital grade disinfectant. In some of our buildings, we did need disposable hospital gowns as well as shoe coverings. And then, of course, as I mentioned before, we are hiring 2 nurses and 4 social-emotional learning specialist. We purchased electrostatic sprayers for disinfecting. We purchased air purifiers for all areas where our students were engaged in learning. We have signage throughout the district. We also have new water fountains. Well, they're actually bottle filling stations, and we've covered up the actual water fountain component, but that was a significant investment. And most of that, in terms of the water filling station, came by way of the Oakland County CARES grant. So I would once again like to thank Oakland County for their support. We made a small investment into the Ascension Southfield School-Based Health Center. Ascension is paying $450,000 to install the health center. The district agreed to pay $50,000 to upgrade the air quality in that space. We also have Community Pass, which is the online registration and payment software for the school. This will afford our families an opportunity to make payments directly online. When lunch does come back online for payment, they will have an opportunity to make those payments there. They can make senior dues payments, field trip payments, or any other payments, Saturday school, summer school, and the like, there through Community Pass. That is all for the back to school piece. I do have some legislative updates, but I wanted to take a moment and pause to see if any trustee had any questions regarding anything that was shared thus far.
Okay, so I'm gonna go back to the beginning, and then with the shortage, the shortages.
To the community concerns?
No, the shortages with the staff, primarily, because I've also been reviewing the talent management action report. And so to your point that you made about the shortages across the nation, which we know we've been experiencing for quite some time, I wanted to raise the question again regarding MBE's interim certification program. Have we considered, are we tapping into that? First is the first part of that question, in terms of looking at utilizing that with some of our current staff who may meet the qualifications. And I just want to be clear, because when this has come up in the past, there's been this misconception that this would allow for persons who are not qualified to earn or be given a certification to be in front of our students, and that's not true. There are qualifications that, so for instance, if a para, for instance, has a bachelor's degree but not in education and has not yet passed the MTTC or is on a path to pass the MTTC, that would be a person who will qualify to have a district apply for this type of interim certification on their behalf to then fill a vacancy for a year. And then there's, of course, programs that, or there's ways that you can enter into a partnership with MDE for an extended amount of time and all of that. Dr. Green, have we looked into utilizing that to help support these gaps we have?
Yes, ma'am. We are looking into that, as well as applying for emergency certifications. I'm sorry, mute that, Ms. Norris, so that we reduce the feedback. Oh, okay. We are also applying for emergency certifications for individuals that may qualify, particularly in the area of special education, and with some of our paraprofessionals and others throughout the district, if they are interested in substitute coverage as well, we are applying for and paying for those as a district. As you continue to hear of new and innovative programs, by all means, please lift those to our attention, because we are actively seeking all partnerships to ensure that we have certified individuals in front of our children.
Okay, I do have a framework for a program utilized. Not that we have to replicate that, but I think it would be good if we're serious about having a conversation about how we might structure that. I think that it would be worthwhile to have a conversation.
Absolutely. If you could forward that to my attention, and then let's schedule some time to meet and discuss.
Okay. And then also transportation. the field zone transportation, are we still in partnership with that to transport the students over to the field zone? They currently have pushed their start date back to October 7th, I believe, due to their structure, their infrastructure, and all of that requirements, COVID requirements. We had been providing transportation for the students over to the field zone held over in at the Southfield Parks and Rec. Are we still doing that this year?
I've not heard that that transportation has been discontinued. I do believe Ms. Venable is on the call. She could speak to that. She is on the call. Ms. Venable, if you could unmute.
Good evening. Good evening, Honorable Body and Dr. Green. You're absolutely right. We have no intentions on not providing that service to our students.
Okay. We already went over that. Sorry, just trying to catch up with my notes. The ESSER dollars, you mentioned about the $14 million. Does Congresswoman know about that? Have we?
Yes, we've been in constant communication relative to those dollars being held up. They are not being held up at the federal level. The state of Michigan actually has those dollars. It is being held up in current legislation. Therefore, we need everyone to actively reach out to your elected officials, and really not our elected officials in our area, because they are doing an amazing job advocating on our behalf. It's some of the other areas that are slowing down the process in terms of releasing those dollars to the districts. The dollars are in the state.
Okay. Okay, and do we, not to move too far ahead into the agenda, but for the September 28th meeting, do we have any schools coming before us for reports? And if so, if SRAC is not on that agenda, can we hear a little update about that or where we're going with that? Do we have any schools coming?
Actually, the next study session was slated for that of MyKIP, which is the new school improvement process. And then we had a monthly rolling agenda, which did incorporate all of the schools to come before us. However, to your point about Southfield Regional, we also need to have a conversation regarding the graduation credit hours for our students. During the pandemic, the trustees agreed to lessen the hours to that of the state minimum requirement being 18. Now that we are back in school 5 days per week, if we revert back to our normal graduation credit hours, that is 22. That would place some of our students, or could place some of our students, in a deficit having just returned from the pandemic. So in addition to Southfield Regional conversation, I do ask that we lift the credit hours into the conversation as well.
Okay, and then along with that, and my last, this would be my last remarks here, the iReady, because we've already taken the fall, or at least we're wrapping up the fall assessments. Can we speak to what we're showing and seeing as a district data-wise?
I don't believe that everyone wrapped up just yet, but I do have that on the calendar for the October meeting.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, Ms. Norris, if you would advance. Now to the legislative updates and some of the reason that things are being held. Many of our proposals are tie barred to other proposals, meaning that the Senate or the House does not want one to pass unless they can have the other one pass as well. There were a number of bills presented this past month, but I wanted to extract these because I think these are most significant relative to where we are in terms of our health. Senate Bill 600 in particular, it is a bill that states a school district shall not adopt or implement any policy that requires students to receive an EUA vaccination. So EUA is that of emergency use. So the only fully approved vaccine at this time is that of Pfizer. When it was first approved, it was approved for emergency use. So this would prohibit the school district from adopting anything relative to an emergency use. This also would prohibit a district from discriminating against or treating differently any pupil having not received an emergency use vaccine. That one is tie barred to Senate Bill 602, which speaks to us not enforcing, us being the local school district, not enforcing any rules from the Department of Health and Human Services for students that are asymptomatic. I want to pause for a minute and reiterate, if the Department of Health and Human Service issues a mandate or an emergency order relative to any COVID virus, this bill would prohibit us from enforcing it if a student is asymptomatic, although that student may be a carrier and can carry to another. That is why it is extremely important that we stay abreast with what is happening in Lansing. Senate Bill 601 is tie barred to Senate Bill 603. 601 adopts or implements a policy requiring face masks. If the school board adopts a policy requiring face masks, it is saying that we shall provide for a waiver process for students and families. However, it does not speak to what those waivers would entail. So anyone could apply for a waiver for any reason in accordance to this particular bill. That being tie bar to 603, 603 states that if an emergency order is issued, that the emergency order would not apply to those students that are asymptomatic, nor would it require an individual to wear a face mask, receive the emergency vaccine, or be tested if the student is asymptomatic. And that's the part I wanted to lift there, because that would prevent school districts from ensuring that our athletes are not positive. It would ensure that any other student in our district is not positive. This would prohibit us from testing students. So I wanted to lift that, and I do have some additional bills that I will forward to all of our trustees. It's important to note that these were introduced in late July, and now all of these bills are currently with the Committee on Education and Career Readiness. As these bills move or die on the floor, I will keep you abreast of any changes. Any questions for that board president?
Is it possible to keep our community aware of these as they go through or are passed on our website or through our newsletter? Is that being done already?
Okay. Absolutely. We will ensure that this information is included in our newsletters, as well as the opportunity for families to ask questions. As I promised our community, we will have a monthly Q&A with the superintendent. It is currently scheduled for next week, Wednesday, I believe. Ms. Paulette will email me or text me if I gave the wrong date, because she is in control of the calendar. However, we will have an opportunity for families to log on and ask any questions of the superintendent or the office of the superintendent, which encompasses all of the executive team, once per month. And this will be, of course, a topic that they can broach if needed.
Any other questions?
If there are no other questions at this time, I would like to turn it over to Principal Sonia Jackson, who will share one of the many innovative projects that we wish to start at Levy Middle School, that being therapy animals. Principal Jackson?
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Green. Thank you, and good evening to Board President, Board Vice President, and trustees and cabinet members, and parents and staff. Thank you for this opportunity this evening. As Dr. Green knows, this has been a few years I've been talking about this, coming to not only Levy, but being a part of the Southfield School District. So first I would like to, and you can advance, Laura, you can go to the next slide. Thank you. I just want to start off with, what is a therapy animal? Because sometimes people get them confused. So a therapy animal is an animal that provides affection. And it's, you would typically see this in schools, hospitals, or retirement homes. They also enjoy the interaction with people, especially people that are in need. Next slide. And I'm not going to read everything on the slide. I will also have this presentation available for those that would like to see it that's on the board. The human and animal bond is very powerful. It helps with pain reduction, mood enhancements, encouraging, physical activity exercises. The therapy dog is trained to tolerate hair pulling, being stepped on, anything that might concern, you know, an adult. What a therapy dog is not, it's not a service or assistant animal that help people with disabilities. A lot of times, you know, we see therapy dogs, we think that they're all under one umbrella, but they're not. And it's also not an emotional support dog, meaning that it is not a dog that would be prescribed by a health professional. And it is not a working animal. So this dog would not be someone that's employed by Southfield Public Schools. It would be kind of like a volunteer. Also, there are some things that we have to do, you know, to get the ball rolling. One is the reason that I'm here tonight, is to introduce this to the district, because we do desire to become a therapy dog. Again, it's been about maybe 4 years I thought of this, because we had so many students that had experienced loss. We had a lot of students that received support services. And I had already reached out because I saw on the news Wallach Schools, they had already adopted this program. And one of my awesome teachers, Ms. Campbell, came to me one day and stated that, you know, she had an idea to get a therapy dog. So that's the kind of staff that I have. I mean, we're always thinking of ways that we can make Levy better. So she kind of took the lead on finding someone and different breeders. But I'll get into that later. But I just want to say that's how the whole idea got to rolling. The cost of to the district, it varies, and I'll get into that later too in the presentation. But I do want to talk about, to get the ball rolling, we have to talk about the insurance. The district would add this our therapy dog as a rider on the insurance policy, the district insurance policy. Next slide. And I know some of the concerns is about allergies, you know, students with allergies, staff with allergies. So I will say this, prior to COVID, I did introduce this idea to my staff. And so we had some staff members, we only had one staff member that was just afraid of dogs. So these are some of the things that we would address before, you know, even if it's approved for us to get the dog, but these are some things that we would consider. No one will be forced to have any interactions with the dog, that's students or staff. And of course, we would have a hyperallergenic dogs only, and also dogs that are, that will be a good fit for our school. And what happens is that it's a long process, and I'll get through this as well. It's not something that's gonna happen next week or next month. It is a process where the dog is fit just for our school and our school community. Also, comparative analysis and support. I have reached out to, because I'm a believer of, if someone is already doing it, why not reach out to them and see how they're doing it and if it's working for them. So I have partnered with Wall Lake School Community, because that was the first school that I saw on the news, and that's what sparked my interest. And Frankenmuth and also Brighton School District, I've developed a relationship with Brighton as well. West Bloomfield, I didn't put them on here. They also had a therapy dog. Their dog passed, and they didn't, they're in the process of getting another dog, but right now they don't have one. I also researched our board policy, of course, to make sure if this was even something that we could do before I even, you know, started the conversation with Dr. Green, as it relates to us having a therapy dog, and it is in our board policy. Next slide, please. So I'm not gonna read this. It is board policy PO2521.02, the use of animals in the classroom and on school premises. So at your leisure, you can read that, but it does state that this is something that we can do as long as it's approved by the board. Next slide. So again, another a few other items of getting this ball rolling is just the estimate of cost. And again, partnering with the Wall Lake, they've been very helpful the last couple of years, and also Brighton School District, very helpful with, you know, telling me and guiding me to the things and also resources. But the estimated initial cost is just training the staff, training students. Someone would come in and train the Levy staff and students. The out-of-pocket cost will be for the dog, but again, we would get donations. I've already had someone that say they would donate the cost of our dog. So we've got that covered. And the yearly cost is roughly around, they said about $1,600 for the dog here. And we're talking about food, we're talking about, you know, shots, grooming, and supplies for the dog throughout the day. Next slide. But with the funding, they also inform me that once we get the community involved, business donations will come in. We can have school-wide fundraisers. Again, like I saw Wall Lake on the news, we can have news coverage, and that's how we also get people to donate to be a part of this. Next slide. So these are some of the things too that we would have to do if this is approved, is address the concerns of our parents, of course, the community, set expectations, and also just make sure that we have our handler training, and make sure that we inform parents that this is a process. It's not something, again, that we're gonna do in 2 weeks. We wanna make sure that we educate our staff in the community. And also we have to have a home for the dog. Now, prior to COVID, when we first started talking about this, and I had spoken with Dr. Green, what we had to do is make sure that someone on our staff was willing to take the dog home, because that dog would have to go home every night with this staff person, and also during vacation time, during the summertime. So we had two staff members that volunteered. Unfortunately, one was a para, he's gone on to be a teacher somewhere else, he's not there, but we do still have a staff member there that's volunteering. We also need a backup person for that. Next slide, please. So what are about the other expenses? Again, the pet store, the food, the vet, the groomer. So what is the catch? The dog is out in the community. What Wall Lake has shared with me is that getting the dog out in the community, whatever vest the dog has on, whoever donates money to the dog, we put maybe a patch of that company that represents that company, and also give whoever that makes the largest donation, we even give them opportunity to name the dog. So we involve the community as much as we can to, you know, get their support. Next slide. Okay, now the dog is, say, in our district, at Levy. So it's ongoing education throughout, you know, the time that we have our therapy dog. We send home newsletters, which I do weekly already. So of course there will be a section in there about the dog. We give dog stories. We send home informational pamphlets, posters. And again, we just advertise it on TV when we can. Next slide. What does the dog's day look like? Okay, again, the dog is not an employee of Southfield Public Schools, so it's not working nonstop. So the dog would have a schedule every hour. So for example, it could be in our media center for reading, it could be in the PE for exercising, it could be in the counseling center, but it does have a prep, it has resting time, and it does not. The dog does not work for treats, and it is never in the cafeteria. Next slide. So these are some benefits as it relates to the curriculum and the learning environment. For example, the motivational purposes, where students are rewarded if they, for academic improvement or positive, just modeling positive behaviors. they're able to spend time with a dog. And I'm talking about that may be grooming, taking a dog for a walk, but they would never, students would never walk the dog alone. Of course, it would always be two leashes, one for the staff member, one for the student, but it's also just a motivational purpose, a reward system. Next slide. So again, as it relates to the learning community, it's been proven, and there's research to show that therapy dogs are used for like reading time, especially for students that have difficulty reading, or just students that just, you know, want to read when they have reading time. Therapy dogs are unconditionally, they're not there to criticize the students. Students have been found to be more comfortable and reading with therapy dogs because, of course, they're non-judgmental. So it helps the student to build confidence. Next slide. One thing I didn't put here in the presentation, and I thought about it later, is also Wall Lake shared with me, is their attendance issues improved, and also their discipline also improved. So those are two things that I didn't include in here, and I thought those were two important things to lift, because we do have an attendance, we know for years since I've been as an educator, as a teacher, and as an administrator, attendance has always been an issue. So also with the writing, again, when we're talking about instruction, give the students opportunity to mail letters or stories that they want to create about our dog. We can create bulletin boards. These are just some of the things that they shared with me at Wall Lake and Brighton that they do. Next slide. Special education, again, this is why I really, really started to do the research, because of our large population and the effects of, you know, having a therapy dog in a school with students that receive support services. And what they found was that it was very helpful for our students with autism, because it helped with their sensory needs, where they're able to touch the fur, pat his feet, you know, rub his ears, nose, and all. Just remember that these things the dog is trained for, so pulling the ears, pulling the tail, it would not cause a reaction from the dog. But it's been shown that this is very comforting for our students with autism during storms or during drills, like fire drills, tornado drills, and things like that. Next slide. Also, our students that receive speech support, it also helps in that area, where students we have students that are nonverbal that respond to therapy dogs, and it's research, a lot of research that supports that as well. The therapy dog also understand hand signals, where these are taught to our nonverbal students. And again, we're talking about our ASD students that are nonverbal. They're still able to communicate with a therapy dog. Next slide. And then we're talking about character education, which is huge and which is so important. I think that this is an area where it'd be very impactful, because it's also shown that with the therapy dog, it is an excellent tool to model behaviors. Respect. We talk about that we could use the dog to show examples of not the dog jumping up or kissing or licking, making sure that they are respecting personal space, responsibilities, where we can give students that that we'd want to, you know, give them responsibilities of taking care of the pet, giving them duties, emptying maybe the mailbox, and selecting students to deliver the mail. To different classes on Mondays, or collecting mail for the therapy dog. Next slide. And these are some other things that also touch on character education, tolerance, citizenship. One of the things that I think it was Brighton, they said, where they thought, I mean, it was a big hit for them, is having the positivity great citizen board, where students, once they have great citizenship, they're on the board, you put their name on a dog bone, and they're part of the positivity citizenship. And also just showing compassion. Therapy dogs are very compassionate. They sense emotional needs. I'll share a personal experience with a therapy dog that I had when my mom passed 3 years ago at the hospital. Immediately when she passed, they brought a therapy dog in for me and my sister. And it was very impactful. So with the compassion, they sense the needs of a student that is brought to the counseling center, or a student that is crying or anxious, they're trained for that. Next slide. And also, even our students that are seeing occupational therapy or physical therapy, they have an opportunity to walk the dog. They have an opportunity to tie bandanas or tie their vests on or buckling their harness. So they can also have an opportunity to be a part of our therapy dog as needed to reinforce some of their therapeutic goals. Next slide. And also, again, I kind of touched on this already, just a behavior model to model positive behaviors. Again, that's one of the things that Brighton School District and Wall Lake said was huge for them, is they saw a decrease in referrals, decrease of discipline, because the dog is modeling positive behaviors. Next slide. So what else is there? Just some important things. I talked about the allergies. And again, just a reminder, students can walk the dog, but there are always two leashes. One is for a staff member, and then the other is for the student. And the dog that we will select, of course, will be a hyperallergenic dog. Any student that is fearful, we will contact parents. Of course, we will have several parent meetings educating our parents. And any parent that says they don't want the dog near their child, or they don't want their child to interact with the dog, we have no problem of making sure that will have that will, you know, we will honor their request. But again, after talking to the different districts that I've developed relationships with, they said it's very far and few between. And even parents that initially would say that, once the kids come home talking about the therapy dog and, you know, how much they wish they can have interaction, usually parents, every parent is on board. So, but again, we know we may have one or two parents that may, you know, not want their child to be a part of it, and we have no problem with that. Next slide. And the hygiene of the dog, of course, we will have a groomer. And again, you know, getting out, talking to our community where we can have, and I have a list of groomers and pet companies that provide food that was shared with me that we can reach out to, because when I spoke with Wall Lake, they pay for almost absolutely nothing because their community pays for everything. They donate the food, they donate the grooming, they have a veterinarian that donate the shots for the dog. So that's what we're going to be reaching for. But the hygiene needs as it relates to the students being able to be a part of that, of course, will allow students to do like the brushing and things like that. So behavior control, when you're talking about students that have behavior challenges, giving them an opportunity when they're having meltdowns, like our students that are emotionally impaired, and also just giving them opportunity, because many times when you give students an opportunity to be the leader or be in charge or in control, those behaviors are easily corrected. Next slide. And also crisis counseling. So these are just some of the things that therapy dogs address, of course, the emotional needs, but I'm just going to just go right on down to the last one that was added during COVID-19. And what really made me want to push this, and, you know, it's been Dr. Green, we've been talking about it, you know, since last year, and it's just, you know, She called me, and I do appreciate her saying, you know, let's do it. Are you available to do it, you know, for this first board meeting? Because we do have a lot of students that have experienced trauma because of COVID-19. We have some students that have lost parents during COVID-19. So this would be something that I think would be very beneficial, not only to Levy, but also to the district as a whole. Next slide. And again, it's just a stress relief, not only for students, but for staff. They also shared with me that teachers often stop in during during planning time or after school to decompress with the therapy dog. So it's beneficial not only for students, but also the entire Levy community or the entire Southfield Public Schools community. Because again, if there's a tragic event that happened at the high school, or there's something happening at a different elementary school or another middle school, this would be our, you know, Southfield Public Schools. It will be housed at Levy, but it will be a dog that could be used at different schools. So how can this be no cost to the district? Again, what I was told, it varies, and even talking to some breeders, because this is a special breeder. It's just not just a breeder. This is a person that would breed therapy dogs that is, you know, made just for schools or hospitals. And usually it takes about 13 to 18 months to train the dog. The dog will come in, get familiar with the school, get familiar with staff, but it's a whole process. And usually the dogs are about 6,500 to 8,500. So again, we do have a company that has already said that they would be willing to donate. I don't know how much the dog would cost. We don't know, but that's what they said, is in that price range. So we're always looking for sponsors. And again, once we get the word out as a district that this is what we're doing, hopefully the community will be open to this idea if it's approved by the board, and hopefully we'll receive that support from the community. Next slide. So this is just some additional information, some research articles that I lifted that I placed here that you can read at your leisure. But also, if you just Google it, and you'll see the research out there, I have not found anything that was negative as it relates to getting a therapy dog. It is a lot of work. And, you know, I've had discussions with my team, with staff. Again, it's got to be at least 3 or 4 years ago that I even, you know, really, really started. It actually started before that, before I came to Levy. But really just getting the work done and doing the research and building those relationships and partnerships with other schools that are doing it, just to see if it's something that is something that we want to do, and if it's something that we can do. And the positives really outweigh the amount of work that it's going to take. And I'm willing to do that if it's going to, you know, have a positive impact on our school, and not just Levy, again, on the Southfield Public School community. So if there are any questions at this time.
Trustees, do you have any questions at this time? Hearing none, thank you, okay. Principal Jackson.
Thank you for your time.
Board President, that concludes the report of the superintendent.
Thank you, Dr. Green. Action items. The chair will maintain a motion to open and approve the consent agenda, which includes approval of minutes from June and September.
Board President, my apologies. I did have one question regarding Principal Jackson's report.
Sure.
First, a comment. Sounds like a wonderful program. Board President, is there anything we would need to do to move this forward? Was the purpose of the presentation for approval, or was it information? What happens next?
Dr. Green?
It was for information this evening with future approval, unless, of course, one would like to move it to action.
Board President, I see no reason. I have no objections to the program. I think it's a wonderful program. It sounds like Principal Jackson and her team have fully thought it out, have partnered with other districts, so they really have looked in, you know, at all the areas, all the components of it. I have no objections to moving it to an action item, Board President.
So the chair will entertain a motion.
I would like to introduce the motion to approve the therapy animal partnership for Levy Middle School as presented by Principal Jackson.
Support.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Any additional questions, trustees?
Hearing none, Board Secretary, please call for the vote.
Trustee Johnson?
Yes.
Trustee Hicks?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Trustee Rice? Trustee Rice?
Yes. Can you hear me? Okay.
Trustee Bland?
Yes.
Trustee Joyce, is Vice President Joyce with us this evening?
He just acknowledged yes.
Okay. Trustee Ware DuBois?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Motion carried. The chair will entertain a motion to open and approve the consent agenda, the approval of minutes from June and September. It's been properly moved and seconded to open and approve the consent agenda. Any questions and or corrections? Hearing none, Board Secretary, please call for the vote.
Trustee Ware DuBois?
Yes.
Trustee Joyce?
You say yes.
Trustee Bland?
Yes.
Trustee Rice?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Trustee Hicks?
Yes.
Trustee Johnson?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Motion carried. The chair will entertain a motion to open and approve report 60-03, Talent Management Personnel Action Report. It's been properly moved and seconded to open and approve the report for talent management. Questions? I did have a couple of questions. Some of the reasons were identified for reasons why a variety of employees are leaving the district. Do we perform an exit survey?
Yes, we do.
Can I and the trustees have access to see the results from some of those exit surveys?
We will compile those for you.
Any other questions on the talent management report, trustees?
I do. I have that same concern of President, Board President. Thank you for lifting that. My other question is, how have we filled those vacancies as it relates to the instructional staff? And are we still able to honor safe numbers with the classroom sizes, considering the instructional staff we are losing and have lost?
Trustee Smith-Thomas, our principals have been very diligent in ensuring that sections that have very, very low numbers were collapsed and combined so that we were able to fill the classes with highly qualified teachers. Also, we have some individuals that have moved from one facility to another within our district. That said, we still do have some vacancies. We've received support from our university partners by way of having the student teachers in our district to provide additional support and lower the student class ratio where applicable. However, we remain diligent in looking for additional staff members, particularly in the area of for students with special needs.
To that point, follow up before we continue. Yes,
Trustee Smith Thomas.
Okay, what about now?
Yes.
Yes. Can you hear me okay now? You say yes.
Yes.
Okay. To the point you mentioned about the special education, and I don't want to misspeak, but I believe there is there's some new information that is coming up MDE regarding waivers for the special education endorsement for any teachers, some type of program where they're looking to assist districts in that area. Are we familiar with that?
We are, excuse me, we're looking into that as well as a program offered by Eastern Michigan University, whereby those paraprofessionals within the district interested in special education can go directly into the program and receive an endorsement in special education without having to receive a content endorsement as well as. So we are exploring both of those options at this time.
Okay, thank you.
As well as emergency certifications, as I lifted earlier.
Dr. Green, do you have a number of vacancies? Do you have a number?
I do not have the current number as of today. However, I will forward that to you on tomorrow once we compile that list.
Trustees, any additional questions at this time? Hearing none, Board Secretary, please call for the vote.
Trustee Johnson?
Yes.
Trustee Hicks?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Trustee Rice?
Yes.
Trustee Bland?
Yes. You said yes.
Trustee Joyce? Trustee Ware DuBois?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Motion carried. Informational items. Report 6004. Well, before I introduce that, trustees, just for your awareness, bullets A and B, reports 6004 and 5. We would, based on time sensitivity, as we go through these, if you would consider them potentially making them actionable reports. So as they're explained, please look at it from that lens to see what questions you may have.
Board President, does that include the iReady 60-06?
So I was going to let that 6006 and 6007 have already been approved as part of a grant. Therefore, it's strictly for information. Technically, we would not have to approve it because the grant has already approved it at the state level, but for record keeping purposes, if the board would please consider entertaining that as well. So all 1, 2, 3, 4, actually all of the action, all of the information items. Except okay. H, we do need to discuss H.
H, okay. Report 6004, Bussey Center for Early Childhood Interagency Agreement.
This is an annual agreement that the district has with Head Start as a requirement of Head Start. And you can see in the executive summary as outlined by Head Start Performance Standard 1302.63, a program must work to develop an interagency agreement with the local agency responsible for implementing the IDEA, which is the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act.
Trustees, do you have any questions on this item? Hearing none, report 6005, Michigan Rehabilitation Services.
Similarly, this is a program that we utilize with our young adults in our special education or our intense student support network, whereby the students are afforded opportunities to go into the communities, receive work experience, as well as earn monies. While the district invests approximately $12,000 into the program, we receive approximately $50,000 in services for our students. This is primarily utilized with the students at KLC, but we also have opportunities for the students at Southfield A&T as well.
Trustees, any questions? Development 21-22 school year.
This is the professional development required for our staff to be well versed in the iReady assessment. Again, this is grant funded and has been approved by the Michigan Department of Education to provide ongoing support to our staff throughout the 2021-2022 year. I would also like to lift that based on our implementation of iReady throughout the pandemic, we have been invited to speak at a regional conference in Chicago on behalf of implementing an assessment product throughout the pandemic. That said, Ms. Summer Caldwell Carruthers will be representing the district at that conference at no cost to the district. So we're quite pleased with our team and the progress that they've made.
Trustees, any questions? Hearing none, report 6007, Nearpod licenses, 21-22 school year.
Our Nearpod licenses, I believe, are new this year, and I would ask Ms. Summer to unmute and explain this product. Once again, it has been approved by the Michigan Department of Education by way of grant dollars to provide real-time feedback and growth for our students in K-12. So, Ms. Summer.
Good evening, Dr. Green, board. Nearpod is a program that our staff is currently using. They've been asking for it for quite some time. It does provide real feedback in real time to the staff. They can control all the Chromebooks. They can put the students in groups. It's an interactive technology tool that many of our staff members were paying for out of their pocket. And so therefore, we requested it through the grant so that our staff members would not have to pay for the program.
Trustees, any questions on that item?
No question. I happen to be familiar with Nearpod. I think it's a pretty cool tool. So my question is, do we have any objections to making this an action item tonight so that teachers can get right to using it with the students?
So Trustee Smith-Thomas, the goal is after we get through up to 8 is to do one motion for A through G.
Okay, so this is included in that.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a quick question, Board President.
Yes, ma'am.
Does this require any, and I guess this is for Summer, does this require any interaction with the parents? Is this something that you use, or is this strictly the classroom and the teacher?
It's mainly for the classroom and the teacher. And
okay.
It's
K-12
too.
Okay. Thank you.
Trustees, any additional questions and or comment? Hearing none, report 6008, Career Technology Education, Culinary Arts Innovation. We discussed that briefly. Is there any additional question on this item?
Board President, the only other thing I would like to lift is this $21,000 came from the sinking fund, not from that of the ESSER grant.
Excellent. Okay, hearing none. Report 6009, technology purchases, COVID.
This was the technology upgrade that I mentioned regarding the fiber optic cable running from the Instructional Technology Center out to Warrior Stadium to ensure that we're able to broadcast our games in real time.
Any questions, trustees? Hearing none, report 6010, short-term accountant.
In the absence or transition of staff members in the business office, we always want to ensure that we have fiscal accountability in the district. Therefore, we are asking to bring on a contracted retired staff member for a short period of time through January of 2022 to ensure that we are able to comply with all federal regulations, state and local regulations, as well as our annual financial audit.
Question that I have on this item, does this include any knowledge transfer for when you eventually have a permanent replacement in the role of accountant?
Yes, we did discuss a timeline whereby the position will be posted next month. We hope to have someone identified early November for board approval. In the month of November, they would spend all of the latter portion of November and December cross-training to ensure that the beginning of January, the individual was able to perform.
And the question, the short-term account, is this coming from Oakland Schools or is this being sourced somewhere else?
This person having been identified by recommendation from Oakland Schools and other places is not an Oakland Schools employee. This is a retired CFO from a long-serving CFO from another district.
Did Oakland Schools have any resources that could have been utilized?
Not at this time.
Trustees, any additional questions on this item? Hearing none, the chair will entertain a motion to open and approve reports 60-04, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10.
Mm-hmm.
It's been properly moved and seconded to open and approve the named reports. Any additional questions? Hearing none, Board Secretary, please call for the vote.
Trustee Johnson?
Yes.
Trustee Hicks?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Trustee Rice?
Yes.
Trustee Bland?
Yes.
Trustee Joyce?
Yes.
Trustee Ware DeVos?
Yes.
Oh, motion carried.
Board President, did we miss report 60-11?
No, I'll stop that, G. We're going to go to that report now, which is still informational. So report 60-11, DM Berg Group, LLC, Custodial and General Maintenance, Contract Employee Temporary Incentive Program.
Thank you, Board President and trustees. As we've already identified, there is a labor shortage occurring throughout our nation, not only in the area of education, but all other areas as well. That being said, we are looking at ways to incentivize our partners to keep them here, as well as to acknowledge their hard work and dedication having been performed throughout this pandemic. I think people now recognize custodians are just as or equal or more important than that of some of the instructors, because without them being safe, then of course instruction cannot occur. That being said, Ms. Venable has been meeting with Mr. Ingram and DM Burr to discuss an incentive plan. It would cost the district more money. However, given that we've already saved due to the number of employees currently on the roll with DM Burr, it may be cost neutral in the end. So Ms. Venable, if you would unmute and please share the trajectory of this proposal.
Absolutely. Thank you, Dr. Green. So as Dr. Green indicated, we're sustaining a staffing shortage in the areas of custodial services, security, and in bus drivers. DM Burr presented this proposal for an attendance incentive that they're using in some of their other client districts and neighboring districts to Southfield. The intent is that employees who work their intended plan shift throughout the 2-week period would receive an additional $2 per hour for that time. If the employee does not work their scheduled shift, for instance, may call out sick or miss a day of work for any other reason, then they would not receive that additional $2 incentive. Right now, because we're short staffed, and in the board agenda item, I indicate by how many positions, essentially the district wouldn't be paying any additional dollars out of pocket. We would use the savings that's currently in the contract. In the event that all employees were to work their straight 40 hours, 80 hours every 2 weeks, then that $27,000 that's in the proposal would be what we would pay on a monthly basis. And then there's, I extrapolated that out for annual or for the 10 months left in the school year. Right now, I don't see how we would ever actually reach that because we're struggling to find talent and to keep talent in the district.
That being said, the additional funds, if we were responsible for adding to our bottom line, would come from that of grant dollars that would not come from our general fund.
Absolutely.
Dr. Green, I have a question. So I believe it was mentioned by Ms. Venable, security as well as custodial. What about our other services and or employees that would fall into similar concern? Have we had discussion related to those?
We are currently in discussions with our partners, separate and apart from our collective bargaining groups.
Okay. So potentially there may be additional or similar items. I guess my question is, should we be looking at this comprehensively to make sure before we commit to one or the other, what's the impact to the district overall before entertaining moving forward with one over another?
Well, one of the reasons I would ask that we look at them individually has to do with the retention and recruitment of staff, as well as attendance. As people continue to fall ill, we want to make sure that others are not being burned out, they're being compensated for their diligence in reporting and performing their job duties. Also, there is a hiring bonus that's built into this, which hopefully will attract some new staff. Furthermore, the contracts are separate and apart from one another. While we have DM Burr contracted for two different services, we also have two other companies that are not affiliated with DM Burr. So that for those reasons, I would ask that we look at them individually.
No, I agree that we should look at them individually, but it's all coming from overall district pot of money.
It's coming from district grant dollars.
District pot of money. It's all money that the district has access to.
Correct.
So the question is at some point that money is going to be exhausted. So depending on apparently whoever comes first potentially gets taken care of where another one potentially may not.
We've not projected it out that way. There's only a certain amount that we can utilize under the grant dollars. So we have tried to hold that in abeyance to ensure that everyone receives their fair share.
Duly noted. Trustee Joyce.
Given that the expertise of those who are involved, is there a promising objective to this? Is this something promising? Do we know for a fact that to engage and utilize the funds, are we looking at having some kind of success in it?
We do know that this model has been successful in other districts experiencing the same shortfall with custodial services. However, up to this pandemic, there really was not a significant shortage. So we only have 18 months of data to reference.
President, if I may?
Yes, ma'am.
One thing I would like to lift is that every morning I see a custodian helping our children cross the street. No complaints. He's there every morning. He's there every evening. Without him, I can't say that the principal will be able to carry out her duties standing in the middle of a driveway. Directing traffic, ongoing, going, making sure our kids and our parents are safe. So I truly see the value of our custodial staff, not to mention he leaves the parking lot and then goes in and cleans up to ensure that our kids are safe. So I definitely see the benefit looking at the cost benefit analysis and also considering how many people we're losing on a daily basis. We have people that are getting sick. Their families need supplemental income. I definitely can see where this is a benefit, and I definitely need to take the time to say thank you to the custodial staff. I think we tend to take them for granted. So that's just my 2 cents regarding board number 11.
Well, President, if I could also lift that throughout this pandemic, the Michigan Department of Treasury offered a number of COVID bonuses or incentives to instructional staff. While they could never be paid a high enough amount for the additional work that they did throughout the pandemic, I would like to note that they did receive some consideration from the Department of Treasury, as did our paraprofessionals. However, there were a number of our staff members and all of our partners that did not receive consideration from the Michigan Department of Treasury. And truly, and this is just my humble opinion, I think it's unfair that the state provided that for some and not others when all of Southfield Public Schools staff and partners were on the front lines daily.
So just to be clear, I am definitely supportive of initiatives like this. I'm only looking at it from a lens that comprehensively, what's the impact to the district financially to make sure that we can share that love with all of the folk who are providing service to the district to make sure that we minimize or mitigate the risk of potential loss of resources. So I am supportive of this item. With that being said, the chair will entertain a motion to make this an actionable report, or should we wait for additional information? What's the board's pleasure? So the chair will entertain a motion.
Uh-huh.
It's been properly moved and seconded to open and approve report 60-11, D'Amber Group LLC custodial and general maintenance contract employee temporary incentive program. Board secretary, please call for the vote.
Trustee Ware DeVos.
Yes.
Trustee Joyce?
You say yes, I'm sorry.
Trustee Bland?
Yes.
Trustee Rice?
Yes.
Myself, yes. Trustee Hicks?
Yes.
Trustee Johnson?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Motion carried. Monthly financial report.
Board President, in the interest of time and the storm that we heard outside, the financial report has been shared with all of the trustees and our community. If there are any questions, Mr. Ingram, as well as Mr. Thomas Harrell are on the line to entertain, to respond to your questions.
Okay. Bill disbursement.
Same with the bill disbursement. All trustees have those items as well as in our community packet, showing the expenditures having been paid out throughout the months in which the board did not meet in session.
If you wish to public participation, if you wish to address the board regarding a school related issue that has not yet been resolved by administration, please submit a comment card if you're physically present, or please raise your hand if you are participating virtually. Comments are limited to 3 minutes per individual. As a matter of fairness, speakers with complaints against individuals are asked not to mention any persons by name. Complaints concerning employees pursuant to Board Policy 9130 should be brought to the attention of school principals or other administrators before coming to the Board of Education. Your cooperation is appreciated. Mrs. Norris, do we have any hands raised at this time? Mitchell, please state your name and your address, please.
Dorina Mitchell. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Dorina Mitchell, 3607 South Bassett, Detroit, 48217.
Please proceed, ma'am.
I would like my children to participate in virtual school. But if I heard you correctly, you said that the school is in Southfield, Oakland County.
I'm sorry, ma'am. Please finish your comments and your thoughts. Or was that the conclusion?
Yes. Yes, I was saying I wanted my children to participate in virtual school.
Okay, ma'am. So what we'll do is we'll have staff respond to you related to your inquiry.
Okay. Can you tell me, is it on Southfield?
Ma'am, we'll have them respond to your inquiry. Thank you. Ms. Banks, please state your name and your address, please.
Hello, this is Marie Banks. I'm at 29506 Andover Boulevard in Farmington Hills, Michigan. I just wanted to welcome everybody back and good to hear everybody. The year is starting off good. Actually, it's starting off great. Just wanted to, my daughter that goes to MacArthur in university, I know there's going to be some work in the parking lot. I don't know if that was on the list, but the roads are really dangerous. And I noticed when it rained earlier this week, it was flooding in certain parts. Also, I wanted to bring light to the football game last Friday. It was a great, my daughter participated in the Young Future Warriors cheerleading program, which was really well ran. And the kids had a great time. And I thought it was a great outing for Southfield. And I also wanted to bring support of the athletic department. The new athletic director has been transitioning well, and I hope that he continues to get the support that's needed. I appreciate, went to a volleyball game in North Farmington today, right down the street. But everything from the academic perspective is going well. Few tweaks with the roads at university. Athletics is going great. Still don't understand why we needed a new athletic director, but the athletic director that was hired is great. Hope he gets his support that he needs to stay successful. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Baker. Listen, there's no additional public participation at this time. Is there anything for the good of the order?
Yes, Board President.
Yes, ma'am.
Wanted to remind that the and make the public aware that the MASB's annual leadership conference is set to be hybrid this year, and those dates are November 11th through the 14th. I am planning to attend. I will participate in some hybrid, basically. Some of my attendance will be in person and some will be virtual. And for any of the trustees planning to attend registration, the registration deadline is September 24th. So Ms. Norris, Board President and Superintendent, you can look forward to me submitting an email sometime this week with my plans for attendance. Also, throughout the summer, I have been continuing to be involved with Oakland County School Board Association. And one of the main topics being discussed right now is the critical race theory, which I think is quite interesting. We've been talking about it both the county level, and it's also a conversation happening with MASB. I will look forward to hearing more as there are some thoughts of how do we adopt this mindset in our policy making. So a lot of it is really conversation right now, but I'm looking forward to continuing those conversations and bringing more to the board as those interactions continue. Also, I wanted to ask about the board operating procedures. The documents that were sent by the superintendent, this was actually a document I sent some time ago to you, Board President, as this was the last, that 2017, that was the last document we kind of left off on as a board when I was leading that committee. My question is the expectation, are we looking to adopt that? Are we looking to pick that up again with committee work? What is the expectation as it stands right now as it was sent out?
So I can answer that. I didn't ask for it to be sent. Is there a recommendation of the board related to that item?
That you're hearing from, that you're asking from me?
Well, I'm asking from any trustee. I mean, I didn't request that be sent out, so I'm not sure what the intent was.
So, Board President, if I may, I sent those out after speaking with MASB regarding the request for goal planning and future discussions around setting goals for the district, both for the superintendent, as well as the board and the district as a whole. So we were just pulling together all of the documentation that existed in the office of the superintendent. So that's for whenever we meet with Deb Macon to discuss goal setting.
Okay, very good. So I'll put a pin in it. I'm glad to see that document has resurfaced and we can at least start to look at it again in moving forward. And then the last item, I just want to remind the importance of the parent reports as we're moving forward with completing. I know we don't complete the assessment for iReady until mid-October, but that we, as we're looking to engage in that PD for our teachers, that we're also including parents in those parent reports district-wide, and in those conversations about the importance of involving the families in some of those data chats, and how to move forward from our fall assessment into our winter and then ultimately our spring assessment as we look to grow our students this school year, and not only in the school, but also what the families and the parents can do to assist in those efforts. That concludes my board matters.
Thank you, Trustee Smith Thomas. I did have a couple of things for the trustees related to the good of the order. First thing, during the meeting with the board vice president and superintendent, we talked about the cadence of this meeting and the focus of this meeting. The goal would be to have action items, but more importantly, to have call outs to things going on within the district. Historically, we've had it where we would give accolades to teacher, or I'm sorry, it wasn't teacher of the month, it was employee of the month. We had highlights from various activities within the district, whether it be clubs, sporting events, just to get some highlights and directly celebrate students and their achievements, as well as to give, like I said, the action items for that need require action of the board. My ask would be for us to minimize the number of informational items for regular meetings, just so that we can keep the attention of the community and make sure that they're hearing where we're going as a board and to understand the work that's needed from them to support us. And with that being said, many of the items that are informational, I'm asking that we have additional study session where we can take deep dives if needed on items being brought before the board. With that being said, on the 21st of September, I'm asking if there's availability from the board so that we can review and update a variety of policy that's outstanding. As mentioned briefly by Trustee Smith Thomas and Dr. Green, we had talked about having a goal setting discussion. So with MASB kind of helping lead us to understand, you know, what kind of goals we could potentially seek as a bar for the district as a baseline. So I'm asking that maybe on the 28th, we can have that discussion in addition to having the discussion on the operating procedures in that study session. And if there's any other informational items that, you know, administration would like to present to the board. But also, trustees, I'm looking for input from you all on topics that you want to have covered from a study session perspective, so that we can make sure that we include that in discussions going forward. So, you know, our cadence had been second Tuesday, we have regular meeting. Fourth Tuesday, we'd have study session. But with everything that's going on right now, we may need some cases two or potentially three study sessions over the course of the month. And the reason why I say that is that I do this professionally, that I don't believe any meeting over an hour is productive. At some point, we kind of glaze over things and check out. So I just want to make sure that we're giving the necessary attention and due diligence and understanding, you know, and if they go over, I'm cool with that. But I just don't want us to shove too much into a meeting and we not get the true value and understanding needed to move an item ahead. So I just wanted to stop there and trustees, hear your thoughts. Does what I said make sense? Do we want to tweak it? I'm looking for input so that we can plan accordingly. Oh, yeah, thank you. So one of the things that I wanted to lift is that, you know, as we grow into this model, it was important. First of all, thank you for being here in person. I believe that you all are, and those who aren't here had the desire to be here, but things came up. It's good that we are leading by example. And so thank you for coming to the regular meeting. My ask would be is with these additional study sessions, we could continue the hybrid or the virtual model so that we can make sure that those who do want to participate can hear us clearly until we get to a point where we can stop wearing these things as open. So for these study sessions, they would be virtual. But for the regular meeting, we would try to continually make this thing work until we can eventually get out of the mask. So with that being said, I'm open. These are just suggestions for me. I'm looking for feedback from you all on how we proceed.
I think that a lot of what we discuss can and should be done in a study session atmosphere. It provides us more capability to have larger discussion without taking up the bandwidth of the community's time. So if that is your desire moving forward, I would support that wholeheartedly. So that will be my feedback to that.
Anything else for the good of the order?
I have one.
My apologies, Board President.
I think Trustee Thomas, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. And Board President, once Trustee Blandon is done, I did have one other item.
Okay. She said after you.
I just wanted to thank the community, the staff, the administration, all the hard work over the summer has definitely shown its face as we've launched the new school year. I would just ask that the community be patient with us, that our students continue to thrive in this atmosphere of hopefully post-pandemic. I also would like to commend the board for showing up over the summer for so many things, and always be readily available to support anything that the district has going on. I look forward to working with everyone as this school year continues to grow, and hopefully the anxiety of the pandemic starts to wear off. So that will be my only statement for the good of the order.
Trustee Smith Thomas.
Student hearings. Do we have an update on what's happening with them? A plan?
Trustee Smith Thomas, when we concluded the in-person instruction, we had one student pending for a board hearing. And that student is no longer enrolled in our district. All other students that were to come before the administrative team, all of those students have Well, the student support team did meet with those families, and those students are on plans of support as they transition back into the regular school building. However, the one student that was slated to come before the board is no longer a Southfield Public School student. And hopefully with all of these supports, we will have no students that need to come before you this year either.
Board President, I have one comment.
Yes, ma'am.
Again, thank you to all the parents and staff that have been patient as we get through our couple of weeks. But I do want to ask that parents make sure that they send their children to school with masks. I understand that the board, as was mentioned earlier, have some, a few to hand out as needed. But again, parents, please make sure that you send your children to school with their masks on.
And water bottles.
And water bottles. We want to make sure that they stay hydrated and we keep our staff and administration safe and each other.
And on time.
And on time. Explanation point. Thank you.
No, ma'am. Anything else for the good of the order? So just a checkpoint, had a sidebar. We talked about having a study session next Tuesday. Do you all have availability at 7? Okay. I just wanted to make sure we told you that so that you can start saving that date. So future meetings, September 21st, 7 p.m. Special board meeting / study session. September 28th, 6 p.m. Another board special board meeting study session. So stay tuned for the October study session dates, but that are probably going to follow every Tuesday. So if we could just please hold every Tuesday for now till we kind of get caught up. And October 12th, 7 p.m. regular board meeting. That being said, meeting adjourned. Have a good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, and thank you.